Just a bit of information. So if you want to contact any of the speakers here, you can feel free to do so right after the tracks and maybe during the breaks. And even later, you can just contact us and we will be able to help you to connect with them. Next, we are proud to showcase Desi or Charaka Trust, which is an organization which is the leader in the making and marketing of natural dyed products. They're represented today by Mr. Krishna and Sharda Ganesh from their offices in Bangalore. So please do give a round of applause to both of them. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Sharada Ganesh, and this is my friend Krishna J. We represent the Desi Trust. Desi and Charaka are the brainchildren of Mr. Prasanna, the famous Kannada playwright, theater director, and he is a front runner in the handloom movement. Today, we present to you the story of Charaka. Unfortunately, he could not be with us here today. Krishna will be participating in the panel discussion. I'll be basically taking you through this presentation. So we present to you the story of Charaka. Thank you. So before we go ahead and see what Charaka means, what does it do, let us spend a couple of moments and see what do we really mean by inclusive business. So what we see is in a traditional business, we have suppliers. We have the, they are generally from well-established organizations. Then we have the entrepreneurs or the enterprises which we are talking about, they employ laborers. And then there are the consumers, typically who can afford these high-priced products. And they are generally from the middle class or upper middle class. So in an inclusive business also, we have all these three entities. We have the suppliers, we have the consumers, and then we have the enterprise. So what is the key difference? The key difference here is inclusive business includes the low income communities. So that is where the whole, difference which we are talking about. So let's just see what really it is, what all it includes. It is definitely a core business. Inclusive business is run like any other enterprise. It is sustainable, which means there are ways to make sure that the low-income categories are included in this whole process, which also means that since our country is, a lot of them are from the low-income categories, this is definitely sustainable. And we definitely try to be profitable, maybe not always successful, but it aims to be profitable. Then it creates employment opportunities for the low-income categories, which is one of the key differentiators. So what it is not? Philanthropy. So inclusive business is definitely not charity. It is run like a business. There are profit margins. And we don't really take donations from people and just give it to people directly. We make sure that the people, the low-income communities, are a part of this entire process. So to see how it works, right, let us take an example of the Charaka story. So let me give you a background of how this whole thing started. 20 years ago, there was a group of enlightened individuals, intellectuals who came together. They formed something called the Kavi Kavya Trust. So what is Kavi Kavya Trust? It's basically a trust which is formed by, for cultural purposes. But since it was registered as a trust, they were able to take up projects in the rural sector. So one of the projects which they took up was the working with the Anganwadi workers in the Shivamoga district of Karnataka. So during this time, when they were working on this project, these group of people, they traveled the length and breadth of the district. They interacted with the rural poor. They understood what is their lifestyle, what is their social conditions, what is the culture, what is the folklore. They made sure that they work closely with these people. So one thing started appearing very strongly here. So what they saw is, Shivamoga is basically a hilly region. It is in the Western Ghats of, it's a very rich rainforest. But slowly all these rainforests were getting replaced by agricultural lands. and the villagers started depending solely on agriculture, which put a major problem because it started degrading the ecology and ecosystem of that place. So something had to be done to reverse this. So how could they do that? They wanted to see if they could take the villagers away from the agriculture and give them an alternate form of employment. And that is how this whole thing, they started weaving, introducing weaving in this area on an experimental basis. They wanted to prove that it is a viable option for the people. And you need to remember that unlike many other places in northern Karnataka, Hegodu, where Charaka is actually in the Shivamogga district, is not a traditional weaving area. So weaving was introduced here as an experimental basis, worked out pretty well. So somewhere in 1996, after Kavi Kavya Trust started its operation, started weaving, they actually gave all the infrastructure so built from this to a group of women. So there were 13 women and there were 2 sewing machines, and this was registered as the Charaka Society. And from then on, the women started producing handmade, hand-woven garments. Kavi Kavya Trust assured them that they will market the products as long as they keep up the quality. So Kavi Kavya took up this as an experiment in marketing, and that is how Desi came into existence, to market the products made by Charaka and to market it in a way that it is appealing to the urban audience. So there was a need to create awareness in the urban sector about these rural women, what they produce. And Desi kind of connected these urban consumers to the rural artisans. So after that, Desi started growing just by the word of mouth. And somewhere in 2005, 2006, they introduced natural dyes. So as soon as they introduced natural dyes, they created a niche market because they started producing hand-woven and natural dyed products. And then it just started picking up. And we have tremendously grown almost at a rate of 25% each year. And there are 11 outlets of Desi which market the Charaka products all across Karnataka. 5 of them are exclusively in Bangalore. So let's first understand why handloom. I mean, why did we actually choose handloom? So there are these 4 reasons why we thought that handloom will basically work. So first thing is, India has a very rich tradition of handloom, and they produce a rich variety of fabrics, which is very specific to each place. Now, slowly, the market in the western side, it's increasing. People are getting interested in handloom, but unfortunately, the people in the villages, they are losing interest in handloom, and this is working in a reverse way. So we need to make sure we bring back the traditional weavers back to their profession. So that was one of the key intent of choosing handloom. Second thing is, of course, a very interesting point, because rural women cannot travel very far away from home for work. So they need to be in a profession which will help them earn money, but they need to still be at home, take care of their family, take care of their children. And this kind of worked for us, because when they could not travel from home, we brought the work to them and they took to weaving. The second thing is the tool for social change. Gandhiji started this whole Khadi movement, and basically it started as a movement for emphasizing hard work and self-reliance. And this is also very interesting, because anybody who is around 80 to 90 years of age can still spin yarn, so which means it makes people very self-reliant. And handloom movement, just like the Khadi, is also a very important tool for social change. It breaks the social barriers of caste, and also it brings people from different backgrounds into the same platform, gives them a dignified way of life. The last point is, again, it is ecologically sustainable, because we use natural dyed products, and then we make sure it is less on the carbon footprint by not using too much electricity. So it kind of is builds with this whole idea of sustenance. So now let us go back and understand how this whole thing worked for us. So these are some key principles of inclusive business. So I'll explain to you how each of these, was incorporated or inculcated by Charaka into their movement. So the first thing is the products that Charaka makes are very affordable. It appeals to the urban market, primarily to the middle class people. They manufacture very basic things like, khadi garments, it could be towels, it could be these quilts. So these are very day-to-day usage stuff. So they're producing very affordable qualities. So even for the end consumers, it is very affordable. And engaging local laborers and entrepreneurs. So this whole collective is run by women, and they are all members of this collective. And they're all from the same place. They're, wherever they cannot travel to the Charaka, a place, they are decentralized units that are set up nearby through their house. So a group of women join and they start a decentralized unit and they start weaving there. And this entire process of, except for yarn procurement, happens at Charaka. So the yarn, which is the only thing that comes from outside, is also sourced from the nearby villages. So this is also using the local resources. And then the natural dyes, so whatever, these vegetable peels, whatever is used, is also sourced from the local areas. The next thing is these women, which are part of the collective, they pay themselves a bonus each year, a small bonus, and they have access to health insurance for themselves and their families. And they are having eligibility for home loans if they so wish to, construct houses. And for the communication sake, there is a lot of emphasis given on the culture side of it. So there is a festival which happens, Charaka Utsava, where all these women come together, they exchange their ideas, they just spend their time freely participating in cultural activities. There is a fortnightly magazine, Chiguru, which also runs, where these people are encouraged to share their stories with other women of the collective. So there are a lot of emphasis given on overall, welfare of the women. So the beauty of this whole model is the women are not just employees. They are the people who run this whole collective. And they actually take home whatever the pay depending on the work they accomplish. And these members, they actually are, internalize the culture of this whole place. And they have a sense of pride working here. So this whole beauty of this is the women, overall welfare is the main key and not just, paying wages for the women. So some of the achievements of Charaka. The entire end-to-end process happens in-house except for the yarn procurement. So this whole thing happens and we have been successfully using natural dyes. So there is very less impact on the environment. And then we have not much use of electricity except for ironing. So ironing is the only thing that we use electricity for, but other than that, the entire thing is handloom, maybe just the lighting which comes into picture. So enormously reducing the carbon footprint. And we set up several decentralized units wherever necessary in and around the Hegodu place so women can work right where they are. Then there are outsourced weaving units set up in northern Karnataka, which are primarily traditional weaving villages like Gajendragad, Mahalingpur, Kerur, and Gadag. So the most important thing is Charaka is not sustained by donations, either from Indian or foreign. Even the occasional grants, which are got by the government, is probably like 5 to 10% of the overall turnover. So Charaka is basically running by its own profit. So no presentation is complete without talking about the women who form this collective. So we've just picked up three case studies which we will present to you. So Gaurama has been part of this organization since its inception. She's been there since 20 years. She is well-versed in weaving, warping, and different techniques. And she's also a distinguished Hase artist. Hase is this traditional art. And she represents these designs on files, on the walls of the building, on the different products, even some of the garments. And she has won several awards for this Hase. And not just that, she has got enormous confidence working with Charaka. And she was actually elected for the Gram Panchayat. She contested the election in 2011. She actually represented the Gram Panchayat. She was also chosen for the Taluk Panchayat the same year. And she has discharged her duties as the Vice President of Taluk Panchayat. And in her own words, it has given us her, you know, immense confidence to actually do this whole thing by making sure she has a support system in terms of the women who work there. So Amita is with us for the last 10 years. She passed out SSLC and basically she was looking for some daily wage work. She worked 1 year in a daily wage laborer. Later she joined Charaka. She started from the training process. She did her entire training here and she worked in different departments across Charaka. So she supports her family along with her elder sister and her mother. And she's got, you know, a lot of confidence working here, so she can take up the responsibility. She takes home a decent pay of around 7,000 rupees per month, and she's able to take care of her family. Prema, basically from Honesara village near Hegodu. So after marriage, she went to Sirsi along with her husband. But unfortunately, her husband suddenly passed away, and she was forced to return to her village, Honesara, with her young daughter. And once she came back, she actually started taking training in Charaka. She's worked in different departments, and primarily she's right now working in the dyeing department from the past 5 years. And she's single-handedly, you know, taken care of her family, her young daughter, and she takes home a salary of around 7,000 to 8,000 rupees, and she's able to manage her household. So these are some, just a few of the stories. There are like a lot of unique stories, people from different background coming in, working at Charaka, exchanging ideas. So this whole support system, they actually have each other as sisters to take their support. So what are some of the challenges that we are facing? So one of the primary challenge that we have is around 70% of the fabric that is produced as handloom is actually woven by power looms. So the customers are also left cheated, and this is a huge threat for all the handloom weavers because it is eating into their market. So slowly, you know, power looms are wiping out handlooms. The Handloom Act of 1985, it reserves 11 types of cloths to be woven exclusively by handloom. But some greedy traders have actually started, utilizing the power loom weavers to weave some of these fabrics, which is, leaving the handloom weavers nowhere, because these are the 11 types of cloths which they need to weave, but they're not able to do that. They're not able to compete with the power loom weavers right now. So lack of strict enforcement is one of the major challenges here. The government of Karnataka itself, they have a huge demand for cloth. So around 400 lakh meters of cloth are used by their internal departments each year. And most of this, unfortunately, is sourced from outside the state. So the government is not showing enough intent to source these garments from the state itself and make use of local resources, which we have within Karnataka state. The next thing is, of course, people need to be made aware why we are having this handloom. It is not just a garment, it is not just a fashion statement. In fact, it is more of a social statement, and it is a way of life. So this is what people need to be made aware of. Then the last part is, because of all these hardships, because of the challenges they're facing, the next generation of weavers are slowly moving away from traditional weaving. They're going to the cities, they're going to other professions. So there's always a challenge to, bring them back into the traditional weaving. So this is one of, the major challenges that we have. So now just few points on what happened recently in this whole handloom sector and what we have been doing. Kaimaga Satyagraha, so this is a year-long protest, which was a non-violent protest taken up by the weavers of Karnataka state, supported by weavers from other states like Simandra. There were a lot of padayatras. They went to the different weaving villages as a form of protest, and there were hunger strikes which took place. So the main problem here is, why are they protesting, right? So the problem here is the government is not giving enough incentives to handloom. And to actually make things worse, they are giving more incentives to power looms. So power loom weavers are getting subsidy on electricity and other benefits. And for the handloom weavers, even the single source of light, that's the only electricity consumption that they have, which is just for weaving, they use the light, that is also not subsidized. So this is like, you know, a huge problem. And the adulteration of fabric, which is also resulting in losing of the markets for the handloom weavers. So basically the protest here is, you know, do not kill handloom. So that is what the weavers are actually asking. And there have been several talks. There's a high power committee that has been set up recently. Prasanna has been spearheading some of these discussions along with the heads of the weaver groups, with the bureaucrats. And the Chief Minister of Karnataka has promised to take a look into the matter. And he actually recently, on 10th of December, met with some of the weaver heads in their Belgaum assembly. So these are some of the things that are happening on the government side, a lot of lobbying that's happening. On the consumer side, a lot of people came together to express their solidarity towards this handloom movement. So we launched this Friends of the Handloom on 4th of December in Gandhi Bhavan recently. And a lot of people from different backgrounds, arts, science, you know, theater, and designers from different regions of the country came together to express solidarity towards the movement. And they will be, in fact, lobbying for the handlooms on behalf of the weavers. On the same day, there was also a letter addressed to the Prime Minister of India, which was released. And this basically questions the Prime Minister, is he really sure that whatever he's wearing as handloom, is it really handloom? So it's just a simple letter written by the people, and we are collecting signatures. It will be circulated on the social media. And by 31st of January, we want to present it to the Prime Minister. There is another campaign which will be launched, the Handloom Ambassadors, on 20th of December. So this will be the first of the event in the series, and Mr. Shyam Benegal will be the first handloom ambassador who will be launched. So this is basically a campaign which is launched to you know, sensitize the young people towards the rural empowerment and handlooms. So these are some of our future plans. We want to establish a training institute for exclusively for handloom weaving. It is started in a small way at Charaka. We want to expand it to other parts of the state also. Setting up of natural dye houses. Again, we want to set up multiple units of natural dyes. Creation of wholesale markets for natural dyed handloom. So this is also on the cards, this coming up. Bringing back the dropped weaver. So this is one of the major challenges. Why all this satyagraha? What are we doing all this for? Is basically to bring back the people back to the handloom weaving. And then, of course, we cannot forget the ecology part of it. So we want to do some research and development for preservation of ecology. So these are some of the future plans. So how can you help? So this is the important question. Now, the first thing is, of course, what is already happening. Join the Friends of Handloom. Become part of this movement. And we urge you to visit this place, Charaka. It's a beautiful village, and you can actually go and stay there. The women will be more than happy to show you the entire process, how this whole production happens, can interact with the actual weavers. So definitely it's you know, a nice opportunity for people to go and learn how it is done and understand the pains that people take to produce a simple garment that we wear. And spread awareness of handloom and its rich tradition. So this is something we all have to do. And once we actually have understood and internalized whatever you know, the Charaka is doing, it will be easier for us to spread this message. Urge the government to implement strict policies. So why we are forming all these lobbies are to actually urge the government to speak on behalf of the weavers, because they, okay, I mean, they are busy with their work. They cannot leave their work and always come and spend time with the government in discussions. And finally, you know, be present at the Handloom Ambassadors campaigns. Series is getting launched on 20th of December, which is next Saturday. It's at 4:30 in Gandhi Bhavan. You're all welcome. And Mr. Shyam Benegal, the famous filmmaker, will be coming, and he'll be talking about some of his films and also this whole movement. So we leave you with some of the links. And if any one of you wish to contact us, we are here. Thank you, everyone. Thanks for this patient hearing.
Thank you very much.